Ooga, 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 chaka, ooga, ooga. I can't stop this feeling, and I can't sing worth crap. But I'm gonna put this in the video instead of a rap. Yeah, we're talking about Guardians of the Galaxy, guys. Sorry.
Knock, knock, open up the door.
It's Will.
So, Guardians of the Galaxy. This is probably one of my favorite movies in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I didn't know what to expect from this. Like, they showed that trailer with the, oh, what a bunch of assholes. And it gives them, like, their whole rap sheet of, like, who Groot is, Star-Lord, Gamora, and Drax. And I'm like, oh, these are almost like people you would see in the Mos Eisley Cantina or hang around Han Solo. Which, funny enough, everybody was clamoring that Chris Pratt should be playing Han Solo. Indiana Jones pretty much put him in all the Harrison Ford roles. I'm like, guys, let's chill. Let's see how this in Jurassic World turned out first. And yeah, I kind of agree with it a little bit that he should be in those roles, but I don't want to get Chris Pratt fatigued because Chris Pratt's pretty awesome. All right, but the main story here is Chris Pratt gets abducted by aliens in the 80s after his mom dies of cancer or something. They don't really explain it, but like based on the looks, the mother has died of some terminal disease. He's obviously upset and runs out, and these people called the Ravagers, led by Yondu, kidnap him for his father, which we don't know yet, but they're probably going to touch on in Guardians of the Galaxy 2. He grows up in space and listens to that music, and he's essentially almost like an artifact person, or a junker, as some of them have called him in the movie. He gets like little things and sells them. I obviously want to identify and be like, oh, I'm Cap. Friends have told me I'm like Cap, but I'm watching Chris Pratt as Star-Lord. I'm going like, as much as everybody says I'm Cap, I'm definitely Star-Lord. I'm totally like a goofball. I would totally, at the end of the world, if there was a way to distract like a main bad guy, I would challenge him to a dance-off. I have no doubt of that in my mind. I'm like, oh, we're gonna die anyway. Might as well. Like, hey, what's going on, Sir Nugget? What? You want to go? But I gotta say, this movie also got me interested in the Bendis run. They did like a .1 issue, because that was the thing with that Marvel now was doing. Like, oh, hey, we're doing .1 issues instead of a number one or a number zero. We're adding that decimal point. Woohoo! And I'm like, it got me intrigued, and like I even liked more of it. Like, they added Iron Man to the team. But that's a story for another time. We'll talk about that maybe on a Will's Weekly Pool, or maybe I'll just do a random episode about my love for that run. We also get introduced to Gamora, which I didn't really necessarily know this, but based on my quick Google searches, I just knew, like, oh, Gamora is the daughter of Thanos. We're probably going to see a lot more Thanos in this movie. And he's in there, but, like, this is, like, about all Thanos has done in the movies. He's like, ha, 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 I'm going to get the good guys, or hey, I'm Thanos. What's up, guys? But Thanos has this other guy, Ronan the Accuser. He's a Kree, like, crazy person. He's played by the guy from Pushing Daisies. He needs to get this artifact that Chris Pratt has also just found, because it has an Infinity Stone in it, and Thanos is after those things, and then Ronan finds out, like, oh, hey, this thing is super powerful. Why the hell would I give it to you? I'm gonna use it for my own good. So he turns on him at one point. We get introduced to these characters so brilliantly, too. They're all assholes. I'm just gonna say that straight up. And I'm sorry if you guys don't like me cussing. That's just kind of how I am, and that's the best way I can describe them. Like, I don't want to be like, oh, they're all buttholes. We get introduced to Rocket and Groot, which are almost, they're almost like a, I guess, like almost like a Tony Stark and Chewbacca team up, because Groot only goes like, I am Groot. And Rocket is obviously the brains of the operation. He makes the weapons. They're all after this rock, and they're like fighting each other for it. And eventually the Nova Corps arrests them, puts them in prison, where we meet Drax the Destroyer played by Batista. Isn't his name John or Jason Batista? I forget. Some wrestling fans are going to go, Will, how do you not know that? But Drax also has a vendetta against Ronan and Thanos. I guess Ronan killed his wife and daughter, so he's been like putting all these scars on him and has been training to kill Ronan and Gamora and pretty much anyone associated with Thanos his whole life. And he does this pretty well. His species also, it's a pretty fun quirk. They take things literally, so you have to like be specific, or sarcasm is completely lost on them. And just like, there's a lot of fun moments with him, and I can't wait to see more of that. Eventually, they all team up, get over their differences, and they realize, oh, hey, that stone, like, I even though I'm Thanos' daughter, like, I know he can't have that or Ronan, so we gotta take this to this other guy I know, the Collector. He'll know what to do with it. He gets it. He's gonna offer them a crap ton of money, because this will give him 2 Infinity Stones if you've been watching the Marvel Cinematic Universe movies. Drax sends a message to Ronan and goes like, oh, like, I challenge you right now, like, I'm gonna fight you, being a macho man, which is pretty stupid at this point, because Ronan's still a badass opponent. He's not very deep, but like, I would not mess with this guy if I were any of the Guardians. They're at the lowest point. The Ravagers pick them up and they're about to like beat them or like send them back to jail and get like the bounty on them. But then they team up and go like, oh, hey, like, we gotta stop this guy and get the Infinity Stone. We can use it for our own good. And we gotta send a message to the Nova Corps. We gotta like attack Ronan and stop this. They come up with some crazy plan. And it's pretty solid. Like, I enjoyed like the chemistry these guys have, and the little dogfights and like spaceship battles almost remind me of Star Wars. When I was watching that, I was completely smiling, going like, oh my god. Because this was before Star Wars came out. I'm going like, oh, if they can do this with characters I don't even know, like Star Wars Episode 7. I mean, remember Star Wars? You remember berries? Oh my god. This is so good. Like, if nothing else, James Gunn needs to maybe consider doing a Rogue Squadron movie or a Star Wars standalone movie, because after Guardians of the Galaxy is done in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, I feel like he's set the groundwork that he could do it. Or if nothing else, do the Patton Oswalt idea of combining the Star Wars and Marvel universes. But this movie really surprised me. And I hate being so optimistic and so like uplifting about good movies like this, but this was the year that this and Winter Soldier came out, and I gotta give this a 5 out of 5. I saw this like 3 or 4 times in theaters, so it's pretty much, if you know that I've seen a movie 3 or 4 times, it's pretty good in my book, and it's always got a rewatchability. I love it. I can't wait for the second one. So what'd you guys think? Who's your favorite Guardian of the Galaxy? Who are you looking forward to seeing in Guardians of the Galaxy 2? Let me know in the comments below. And as always, guys, when there's a will, there's a way.